Lieu, welcome to our live stream. I'm here today with Art Prof teaching artist Jordan McCracken-Foster and Kat Huang. Today we are talking about when white artists depict people of color. If you would like to grow as an artist and you can't afford an art class, we've got everything you need here at Art Prof, critiques and tutorials. This is a topic which I think more and more I'm finding people are discussing, because I know right now there are so many discussions about race and ownership of stories. And so I'm really curious to hear from you guys in the chat about these different artists that we're going to be talking about. They're all very different from each other. So the first artist we're going to talk about is Norman Rockwell, who is an American illustrator. We're going to also talk about Brenda Chapman, Simon Wells, and Steve Hickner, who were directors of the 1998 film, The Prince of Egypt. We will take a look at Bryan, Konietzko, and Michael Dante DiMartino, who were co-creators of Avatar, The Last Airbender. Some of you guys may have seen that it's been resurrected on Netflix recently. And we'll also take a look at Shepard Fairey. These are all white artists who are depicting people of color in their shows, in their artworks, and we're gonna dig into that. So this is a stream that we just did really recently. If you guys haven't watched this, this is pretty relevant, I think, in terms of topic, whether we separate the art from the artist. So if you have not had a chance, take a look at this. So let's get started with Norman Rockwell. Kat, maybe you can give everybody a little bit of insight about who Norman Rockwell was.
Norman Rockwell was a very prolific illustrator. Most of his illustrations took the form of paintings, sort of like realistic paintings, quote unquote. But we're talking about him today because he also has some paintings of Black people, of people of color as his subject matter, and whether he was successful in pulling that off. Was that of too deep, too brief introduction? Sorry.
I'd say that works for me. I think we'll you pass this time, Kat, right? Well, the images that I'm going to show you guys by Norman Rockwell, the important thing to know about them is that they're all based on actual events that happened during Rockwell's life. So, for example, this is a painting called Southern Justice. And actually, it's based on a protest. Well, no, actually, this is a protest of the murder that happened. Basically, these civil rights workers were murdered. And so Norman Rockwell created that image. But he's also known as somebody who took intricately articulate reference photos of real people in order to create his paintings. And so you can see here on the right-hand side, there's a reference photo. And on the left-hand side is his painting, Southern Justice. So Jordan, what's your take on Norman Rockwell in terms of his portrayal of people of color?
Yeah, I think Norman Rockwell is someone who I, from my understanding, really respects the stories that he's telling and has an interest in trying to do it as with as little ill intent as possible. And naturally, with the subject matter dealing with race, especially in the time that he was working on his art, it can be very challenging, it can be very divisive. But I think the fact that we're still talking about him today and the fact that we're still analyzing his work says something about the end product of what he created. And so I think there is a level of appreciation I would have to have for an artist like him.
I think the other thing to consider about Norman Rockwell is that, wow, he really did his research, and this is stuff that was happening in his time period. So I do think that I almost see him more as a photojournalist, because photojournalism, I don't think, was quite as widespread as it is today. I mean, photography just exploded once everything went digital. But for example, these reference photos Norman Rockwell took of this little girl to be Ruby Bridges in the painting that you guys saw before. For me, a lot of it comes down to research. Like, does the artist take the time to respect the subject matter enough to really truly understand it beyond a really shallow first reading? What do you think, Kat?
Yeah, I definitely agree with that. Norman Rockwell's research has been super in-depth and very Like, this is the level of respect that you should give a subject matter. Like, for just this one little girl, Norman Rockwell has taken pictures of three different girls and in three different hairstyles, different poses. He even has like the wood blocks for the feet. And I think it already goes to show that he wanted to depict reality and not something that he himself made up. So in a way, this is sort of like him reconciling that he can't just make up something like this. This is too big of a subject that you can't just do it by yourself. You actually do have to consult real people and real subject matters to depict it. And I think he did a very good job in this case.
Yeah, and I think it definitely helps a lot that he's really going the extra mile. And it is hard, I think, to do artworks about events that you did not actually see and experience. Like, for example, this is another Norman Rockwell piece called The New Kids in the Neighborhood. And this one is not about a particular event the way the Ruby Bridges painting was about, but rather it's about a lot of the tension that started to happen during that time period because of the integration of communities and neighborhoods where you start to have something like this. And so I really enjoyed this painting a lot because it just feels very human and it's representing a broader concept in terms of race relations in America. But I think he just took a very intimate look into bigger topics and did a great job. So in my opinion, he really did well. I'm curious to know what people in the chat think about Norman Rockwell, whether you think he did a good job or not. All right, let's move on. And by the way, if you guys want a deeper dive on Norman Rockwell, we do talk about him a lot in this stream where we try to guess if things are done from a photo or not, although I guess we sort of ruined that for you right now. But anyway, you can watch this if you guys want to check that out. And actually, before we move on to Prince of Egypt, Jordan Smith is saying in the chat, I'm working on a piece inspired by current events, and I'm really interested in what people think of a white person drawing black people. Do you think that's an acceptable thing for artists? Jordan, what's your take on that question?
I think we kind of echoed it when we were talking about Norman Rockwell a second ago. And I don't think that it's disrespectful to draw someone of a different ethnicity, but I think it really depends on what you're trying to say and the message that you're trying to convey with that. Is it something that's trying to depict people who look differently than you in a negative light? Are you trying to make fun of them? Or are you trying to misrepresent the culture? Anything like that, or are you really trying to bring awareness to the story and to the world that you're trying to build? Like with Norman Rockwell, what I think is really interesting is that he wasn't trying to bring attention to himself. He just happened to be the artist to paint it, but it wasn't about him. It was about Ruby Bridges and the experiences that she went through.
Yeah, one thing, Jordan, that we've talked about, Jordan in the chat, that is, Jordan in the chat, one thing we've really spoken about is where is the artwork going? Who is the artwork for? Because think about this, if you do a painting and you post it on social media, okay, fine, that can feel more like it's for you because it's on your account. But if you paint a mural that's in a community that's for a very particular audience, that is perceived very differently. What do you think, Kat?
I absolutely agree that the location and all these details about what sort of image this will be and where it will be. And I actually think we did touch on this with a crit clash we did of Falling Woman and how context and setting are very important in terms of image. But overall, it's a very tricky subject. And I definitely think that you have to consider your audience and also who this is intended for and who profits from this image. Like if you are going to portray someone who doesn't look like you and you're going to ultimately profit from it, you have to step back and wonder, is this okay? Is this morally okay for me to do? And also I think it's equally important that you don't feel comfortable with your subject matter. Like if you are a white person, it's going to be easy to depict white people, but it's going to be harder but completely necessary for you to depict people who don't look like you. And there is no clear answer to this, but I think the best you can do is just really talking to these people and considering what your image is going to do and serve for.
Yeah, I think really asking yourself, what is your connection with maybe the local Black community? Have you ever spoken to them before? Have you ever gone into their community? And I mean, it's like, are you talking about it as a complete outsider? You know, and then do you want to foster that connection? Because I definitely have seen people who are like, oh yes, I talked to this one person, I'm done with all my homework now. And I'm like, no, you're not. I'm like, that's such a, that to me is almost worse. It's almost like worse to say, oh, I talked to one person, I did my research, because that's when I think it frustrates me, when people give this just very skimming the surface version and they're not really speaking from a true experience. Let's see, we've got another comment in the chat. Artie is saying, also being open to feedback from people of color is important, especially if they tell you that something you depicted is harmful or derogatory. Yeah, like Kat, I know you did a piece that was about a Mexican family, and you didn't just Google Mexican family and get photos off Pinterest. I mean, you really took the time to talk to one of your friends who I think had a family in Mexico, right?
Right. The process behind that comic was very, very, very long. I did talk to my friends who were Mexican, but I also reached out to like other universities and like talked to their Latinx communities as well. And I'm very grateful for them for giving me their time and their energy to help me create this story. But it's always a tricky subject because whenever I make a story that isn't about me, it's not about what I have done, it is what I can do more in the future. And with that project, like I certainly have done things, but there are also some things I didn't do. Like in the end, I really wish like, oh man, I wish I could have like written a little bit more about their bios and the my sources and really giving them a lot of credit. I had a credits page, but I really didn't think it was enough. And like in the future, what else can I do to improve this story? And how else can I do this in a way that will very much benefit the Latinx community and not just me, you know? And I think this is an attitude that could be taken for a lot of things. It's not what you have done, it's what you can do more. And that's very important to think about as a creator.
Okay, let's move on. And we're gonna talk about The Prince of Egypt. Jordan, can you summarize for people who are not familiar with this film what it was about? Because I'm looking at this now, I'm like, oh my gosh, this was made in 1998. That's the year I graduated college. That was a long time ago. So Jordan, tell us about The Prince of Egypt.
Sure, so it's a movie based on the life of Moses from the Bible and from Torah and the Quran. And it starts off from when he's born and, you know, there's the massive genocide in Egypt and infanticide where they're killing all the baby boys, how Moses survived that and how he goes on his journey to discover that he's the one who's supposed to free the Hebrew people from being captive by Egypt. And so it's a very dynamic movie in a lot of ways. It's one of those that means a lot to a lot of people because it covers a figure that pretty much everyone has heard of. And it's one of the only films that take it as seriously as this one does.
And let me just give you guys some bullet points about how it was made. I mean, so many people work on a production like this. I mean, it's so different than Norman Rockwell, who is a single artist. I mean, you have the directors who we mentioned earlier, and Brenda Chapman, actually, she was the first woman to direct an animated feature from a major studio. And for the film, they did actually consult a lot of biblical scholars of all different religions. And yet their voice actors were Val Kilmer, Ray Fiennes, Michelle Pfeiffer, Sandra Bullock, Danny Glover, Jeff Goldblum, and Patrick Stewart. For the most part, that's a whole cast of white voice actors. What do you think about that, Kat?
I loved Prince of Egypt when I first watched it. I thought this is so beautiful. Music was great, voice acting on par with a lot of great things I've seen before. But then the instant I learned about the casting, I thought, huh, I wonder what the inner workings of this film really is. Because on the surface, as just a viewer of just the film, I thought, wow, I think this is really cool. I think they're doing something very good here. I see characters of color, but then I see the cast and I'm like, there's one token Black person. The rest of the cast is white. It makes me wonder about the leadership that went behind the team. I mean, the film directors, they're three white people. And I'm sure that there were people of color working for this film, but it did feel like they weren't getting any credit or ownership over this film, because most of it would be grunt work. Most of it would just be animating and not directing, having pretty much no say in this film. And I think there's also something that we should talk about in terms of how Moses looks like. I think he is very white passing, and I don't think it is an accident that he is a main character and he looks the way he does.
Well, Jordan, what was it, the really old version of Ten Commandments? Was it Charlton Heston who played Moses? I can't remember.
Yes, I believe so.
Yeah, and he's definitely a white dude. This is an improvement. I mean, this is not the Charlton Heston version of Moses. But I don't know. I mean, Jordan, do you think that was an accident? Do you think somebody really thought that through and thought, oh, maybe they won't know? Like, it's hard to tell. But you're somebody who really knows the film much better than I do. So I'm just curious to know what you think.
Yeah, you know, I don't want to go and assume what the directors were thinking, because this film was made over 20 years ago. And I can't get inside their minds. But I will say that with Moses in particular, there is an interesting shift that happens in the movie, because there's a part that in the beginning, he identifies as the son of the Pharaoh. So he identifies as Egyptian, and you notice his skin is very medium brown. And then throughout the movie, it took me a couple of watch throughs through the movie to really recognize this. But when he starts recognizing that he's actually Hebrew, that his skin color starts to shift to like an olive, like a light olive green kind of color. And his hair texture appears to change as well. And, you know, after watching it again and again, I think it could very well be seen as something that was intentional, because they clearly thought about the shifting skin color. And I don't know if it was for them trying to just say we need this for the story, or if they're trying to pass us off as some sort of white savior figure. Again, I'm not going to, you know, assume what they were thinking, because I think that's unfair. But it does make me question the motives behind all the choices that they made.
We have some comments in the chat. Lila is saying, even today, so many movies about ancient Egypt cast white people. It's in Africa. I'm glad they at least had characters of color. Keith is saying, Italian Renaissance artists painted what they knew, so they made Jesus a handsome Italian man. And GTM says, I think Prince of Egypt is a product of the time. Students didn't believe people of color casts would sell tickets, unfortunately, but at least they did their research, I guess. Yeah, it's hard, because I feel like that's an argument that is pretty common, people to say, oh, well, in that time period, things were different. I mean, things are always different. It doesn't matter what time period it's in. But I mean, from what I've seen, the studios have not changed that much. Things are not that different now than they were in 1998. I mean, I suppose we got Black Panther made, but there are not that many exceptions, and it's still pretty similar. And when it does come down to it, you guys, who really gets to have their faces on this film? It's Brenda Chapman, Simon Wells, and Steve Hickner. And so, yes, we can say all these people of color worked on it, but did they really get the credit that they deserve? And that bothers me, I think. And I know that that's a reality of movies. That's just the way it is. Not all 5,000 people are going to get credit in the same way. And yet that is very common for a lot of these films. All right, let's take a look at the next show that we're going to talk about, which is Avatar, The Last Airbender, which is made by Bryan Konietzko, who, by the way, was in my class at RISD. I did not really know him. I knew who he was, but I never really had a class with him or anything. Anyway, fun fact there. And Michael Dante DiMartino. And I did read a little bit about why they created Avatar and designed the way they did. They said it was because of their love of anime, Hong Kong action films, kung fu cinema, yoga, and Eastern philosophies. And Jordan, you know a little bit about this film, so I'm going to hand this over to you to explain what Avatar is all about.
Yeah, so Avatar The Last Airbender is a show about this character named the Avatar, who can manipulate four elements, which are air, water, earth, and fire. And in this world, there are the four nations, the Water Tribe, Earth Kingdom, Fire Nation, and Air Nomads. And the avatar is meant to keep balance between the four nations. And our main character, Aang, is the last airbender due to a war that the Fire Nation started. And his whole job is to learn all the elements, travel the world, and save the day and stop the war, essentially.
And Kat, can you explain how people of color works in Avatar? Because Avatar is not actually talking about real people. It's these invented worlds and invented people. So it doesn't quite have the same correlation as, say, Prince of Egypt, but I know there is a certain structure to this world.
Right. So this is a completely make-believe world. It is not real, but it is based on very real people and cultures. There are four nations, the Earth, Fire, Water, and Air nations, and each nation is based on a very different culture. For instance, the Earth Kingdom is based on Chinese people, the Fire Nation is based on Japanese people, Water Tribe is with the Inuit tribes, and Air, which one was Air, Jordan?
Tibet.
Yeah, it was based on Tibet. And I think they did a very good job in depicting these cultures in a way that was sort of, it was very general, but at the same time, it was very specific, if that makes sense. They didn't name names, but they tried to be as loyal to the subject matter as possible. And in no way or form were they trying to mock these cultures or expand on stereotypes in any way or form.
I mean, I feel like what Jordan in the chat had said earlier, I feel like so much of depicting people of color, no matter who you are, is just steering clear of those bad stereotypes, because it is easy to do that if you don't watch your step. And I know that as a teacher, sometimes to learn how to do something well, you got to learn what not to do. And I do think that that is definitely the case in a lot of these situations. Well, before we dig into Avatar, we have a comment from Yovel Naomi, and they are saying, do you think people of color characters have to be portrayed by people of color people? What do you think, Jordan?
That's a really tricky question. I guess it really depends on what the director wants. I think it's always more authentic when you have someone who is part of that culture play a character who looks like you. For example, in the film Spider-Man to the Spider-Verse, there's a character in there, Miles's mom, her name is Rio, and she is a Puerto Rican mother who lives in Brooklyn. And for the voice actress, I can't remember her name right now, but they actually got someone who spoke Spanish, who's born and raised in Brooklyn and was a voice actress. And you can hear it in the movie how authentic that feels. And so I always love when people go the extra mile to do those things. And again, I'm not trying to be some sort of gatekeeper to say whether or not it's okay for someone who's white to voice a POC character. I don't think that's my role. I don't think I'm in a position to really say. But I think, again, the question has to be asked, why are they doing this? Is it because they were just happened to be right for the role, or was it because they intentionally ignored people of color to voice the character? It really depends. I don't think there's any one solid answer.
I want to add on to this and just say it's a question of, like, do they have to? Not necessarily, but why not, you know? And as you said before, Jordan, the voice actress for the mother in this Spider-Man into the, sorry, I'm like blanking right now.
Yeah.
The Spider-Verse film. It's this character just came to life so much more because of the authenticity of the voice actress. And why wouldn't you want that for all of your characters? Because ultimately the voice actress gives life to this character and gives authenticity. And you're only going to benefit from doing that. I think it's also good to say that there is no like one answer to this. For instance, if anyone knows Samurai Jack, it is an animated series on Cartoon Network. The main character, Jack, is a Japanese man, but he's voiced by a Black voice actor. And I think he does a very good job at it. I mean, he's imitating a slight Japanese accent, but it is from something he has observed. And I don't think in any way he was trying to mock the Japanese culture by doing so. And he did a good job. And I think we have to give credit where it's due. So there's no one answer, but just ask yourself, why not? Why not have an actual person who looks like this character and is this character be this character?
We have a super chat from Damara. Thank you so much for your support. Super chats are always appreciated because, as you guys probably know, we run entirely on donations and we don't charge for any of our content. So we always appreciate your support. Well, I'll tell you guys, I have not watched Avatar. I know that's sacrilegious to you, Jordan, but anyway, someday I'll get around to it. For me, one of the big differences with Avatar and, say, Prince of Egypt is that we're talking about a completely fantastical universe that does not exist for anybody, okay? We all are in agreement that Avatar does not exist in the real life. And I do feel that when you put things in a fantasy context, you can do more. I feel that the likeliness of getting somebody upset about something goes down a lot. Now, that said, though, I mean, I don't know a lot about Avatar, but I can tell just from looking at these stills. I mean, this is an image of them standing on the Great Wall of China. And obviously, if you look at some of the other images, I think it does have some connection stylistically to anime. So Avatar is not totally separate from the real world, but there certainly are connections. And Kat, I know you said at one point that a friend told you they thought that Avatar look like white people anime. Like, what did they mean by that when they said that?
I feel like they were trying to take all the ways that Japanese anime was more freeing in terms of like facial expression, action, art style, the eyes, the expressive eyes, and they just wanted to make a series that was digestible for the white or maybe just the US market. And as someone who watches a lot of anime, I totally understand what my friend is saying in terms of saying that Avatar feels similar to what white people think anime is. But at the end of the day, I do have to acknowledge that it's a very good series. It's a very good story, very good characters, also very good research into different East Asian cultures.
Eloise Sherrod, who is, by the way, one of our teaching artists here at Art Prof, is saying in the chat, there's a very real issue of actors of color are routinely overlooked for what few roles exist, whereas the white actors are compensated and paid and are able to further sustain their careers. Well, let's dig back into Prince of Egypt for a second, because we were talking about all of those white actors that were the voices. And I think for a lot of movies, yes, it's like, okay, Ralph Fiennes' voice is in this movie, don't you want to come? And I know it's like a big marketing thing and everything, but again, it's like, think about how many voices are out there in the world that they could have tapped into, but did not somehow. So Jordan, what's your take about the voice actors?
I mean, it's so tricky. First of all, I think they did a good job for the film. I think that, it's very, very difficult to say why people of color were not chosen to voice act these characters, because it's very clear based on the geography, the history, there's so much evidence where we have an idea of what they would have looked like. And for whatever reason, why they didn't choose someone who might have been a more authentic choice to act out these characters and bring them to life, I don't know if we probably will never know. And it's unfortunate, but I think someone said about being a product of the times, that's possible. And also, I don't know, I don't know if it was a question in 1998. I don't really know. It's one of those things I can't really, it's hard to determine, I feel like in 2020, we're much more aware of these choices that go on behind the scenes, but I don't know if that question was ever asked during the development stages. If someone was there, let me know. I would love to figure that out, but I'm not sure.
We have another comment in the chat from JS. In ATLA, their cultures are inherent in their identities. It's core to the stories. The show is grounded in various East Asian cultures, making them white, no good reason for it. Well, here's the thing. I think out of all the examples we're looking at, Avatar for me, just because it's fantasy, I have less issues with it. But I sort of don't think it's an accident that the creators are two white men. I mean, Kat, what if you and I wanted to make our own Avatar The Last Airbender, two Asian women, and we go pitch it? I mean, do you really think you and I would have had the same shot at that?
No. hands down, no. And that makes me very sad. Sorry.
Well, yeah, because I mean, I'm Chinese. I mean, you're Chinese too. Maybe we could go get somebody who's, you know, fulfilling some of the other ethnic roles of Avatar. I don't know what they are. But the point is, if I was with a group of a bunch of other Asian women and we wanted to make a show, I just don't think we would have as good of a shot as two white men. What do you think, Jordan?
So I have some family who have worked in Hollywood, and they have all come to me and have told me stories about how people of color are not very much appreciated in Hollywood all the time. There's plenty of complaints that especially come out in the last couple of years from actors saying that they're not getting as much screen time, or their characters depict a very negative stereotype, or whatever the case may be. And so it's really unfortunate. It's one of those things that I feel like has to be worked on from the inside out, and has to be really, you have to really go to the people in charge and say, why is this happening? As a matter of fact, so last couple of weeks I've seen things on Instagram and Facebook where a lot of Black artists in particular are talking about the animation industry. And I think the statistic is only 5% of the industry in America is filled with African Americans or working, which is really sad when you think about it. Like all the companies, all the studios, all the projects, and 5% are filled with Black people. And I'm not even sure what, you know, the Asian or population or Latino, but it just really, it bothers me when you think of how much potential there is to tell these unique stories and display a whole new world, a bunch of different worlds that we could be seeing. And it just feels like the opportunity is taken away because of some sort of prejudice that's out of our control.
And I have to say, guys, that is not isolated to movies. It's like that in academia. It's like that in children's books illustration. I mean, that this is not one field we're talking about. This is pretty chronic across the board. Well, another artist we'd like to talk about is Shepard Fairey. So he's another American white male who got very, very popular because of this Obama Hope poster, which I'm sure a lot of you guys have seen, that was really, I think, carried the image of Barack Obama's 2008 presidential campaign. It was all over the place. But if you don't know the story, he actually totally ripped off this photo by Associated Press photographer Manny Garcia, and there was a lawsuit about this. And so I think we can tell where he got his sources. It's not very hard to see, but it's not isolated to the Obama poster, because a couple of years later, Shepard Fairey did this series called We the People. And so they're this representative of women of color from different cultures. And I have to say, out of all our examples today, this just makes me mad, because I just feel like this is all about him. And really, do we need Shepard Fairey to show us a Black woman? Like, there's nobody else who can show that to us. What do you think about that, Jordan?
Yeah, so the thing about this is with Norman Rockwell, right? I mentioned that it felt like it was something that he was sort of detaching himself from, and he wanted to do the best job that he could in making an authentic painting that told the story. With Shepard Fairey's work, it feels very propaganda, very, very much like propaganda. It feels very removed from the statement that is trying to be pushed. And, you know, I'm not sure if it's something he recognizes himself, but it does come across as something that, it feels like something that he didn't get a whole lot of input on. It feels very much like he was in a studio and he said, this is what it's going to be. And even with the color choices, it's not even showing them by, you know, as people of color, really. You could maybe tell by their hair or something like that, but even that aspect is removed because they're, you know, these, you know, blue and like a bright yellow, white color, what you have, cream color, you know. So it's really very controversial, I'll put it like that.
Kat, what is your take on Shepard Fairey? Do you get the feeling, looking at his images, that he did do his research, or is this just Google image search, Latina woman, I'm gonna turn this into a poster?
It feels very general. I don't feel like any of these women are very specific. And I think that's very unfortunate. I do want to point out that by the time he did the We the People series, Shepard Fairey had a huge platform. I mean, he did the Obama poster, for which he did plagiarize, but he's already famous. And by the time the movement comes around, the sort of trend comes around to depict more people of color, that's when he starts making the We the People series. And it feels like it just benefits him. I don't think he's trying to lift up any voices who aren't portrayed as well in media. I feel like he's just using this to amplify his own voice, which was already quite strong to begin with. And it's a very unfortunate situation.
Well, so this is very interesting. We have a couple people in the chat. Lila Zig says, I love Shepard Fairey. I always assumed he was black. And MC says, it's clearly a Photoshop filter that he smoothed out in Illustrator. And Lila's adding, knowing he's white changes my whole perspective on his art. And JS says, I think it's sad but true that getting white people to acknowledge people of color often means hearing about people of color from other white people because they're more willing to listen to them. Yeah, none of this is good. And I think what really bothers me about Shepard Fairey is that I don't think he thinks outside of himself. Like, here's the thing. Jordan, you were talking right now about how people are trying to really raise a lot of Black voices in the arts community to give them more visibility than they've been given in the past. And so actually, somebody I know who's a white male artist posted on Instagram, they said, you know what? I could make art right now about Black Lives Matter, but I feel as a white man, the world doesn't need more of that. The world does not need another white man making images of people of color. And so he said, you know, I'm going to start talking about it in this way. And these are some of the initiatives I'm going to do. And so for that artist, it didn't have anything to do with making art. They wanted to contribute to Black Lives Matter in a completely different way. And so, yeah, with Shepard Fairey, I do question his motives. What do you think, Jordan?
Yeah, I mean, like we said, pretty much at the very beginning of the stream, it really depends on the intent and the reason they're going to create this piece. And if it's, you know, I've talked to my one black friend, my one Asian friend, my one whatever friend, and they said it was okay. You know, there's that toss, right? There's that, you know, there's a whole lot of things to juggle in that moment. And so with Shepard Fairey, I think that there definitely needs to be some reconsideration for his whatever process he uses to create his work. And for anyone else who's, you know, if that's something that maybe they're struggling with or they're questioning whether they should make a piece. And, you know, I don't know. I don't have the answer for every single person, but I do think the best question to ask yourself is, what are you really trying to say? Are you trying to bring more attention to your art, to your page, so that you can get more followers? Or are you really trying to bring awareness to this social climate that we're in and talk about the injustice that's happening?
We have a question from Simple Triskel in the chat. Is it reasonable to try to add people of color representation in social media by creating art not for sale, more like fandom related, so that more people of color are represented? Or is that problematic? What do you think, Kat?
Oh my gosh, it's a tight rope to balance on in terms of depicting people who don't look like you. Ultimately, everyone should, if you're an artist, try to depict people who don't look like you. I think it's a responsibility as a creator to do so, but to also very much consider who is benefiting from your doing so. And if it's like fandom art, like on your Instagram and something like that, I think that too is also sort of like a weapon to hold. Like, you could go wrong in there too. And you just have to be super careful about it as well. But I also just don't want to discourage anyone from creating or creating images that of people that don't look like you. I mean, in a world of fiction such as Avatar: The Last Airbender, you can do anything. But then with that great power comes great responsibility. And you have a responsibility to know that even though you intend for something to be good, you have to know what impact it will have and if it will actually be what you intend it to be.
For example, I know a lot of you guys are asking questions about art you're making right now about Black Lives Matter. I would encourage you guys to share it in our Discord, because we actually have had conversations in there where people said, oh, is this offensive? And we've said, yeah, maybe you should think about this. Or we've actually looked at some pieces where I've said to them, are you aware that a lot of people are going to look at this and think this? And I've had people say to me, oh my goodness, I had no idea. And so sometimes a more contained space that's not so public like Instagram is a good way to try that out. We do have an Art Prof share today. Art Prof share is when you guys create an artwork based on or in response to one of our videos. The Art Prof share today is Aurora Brown, and you can see we're looking at an 8-minute back study that she did, and we also have this one as well, which is another back study, and these are basically from my live draw-along streams where I do figure drawings, and a lot of you guys are drawing along with me, which is really, really fun to see. So, Jordan, what do you think about Aurora's piece? How do you think she did?
I think these are a lot of fun. I especially like the fact that it is a back study, just because a lot of times people want to do the front, the torso, because there's, you know, it's more common to see. It's fun to draw the face, things like that. But with this, when you draw something from the back and you're able to mix in the color and pay attention to the bones and the muscles there and come up with a composition and image that's overall very pleasing, I think that's always, you know, something that's really good to shoot for.
Kat, what do you think about Aurora's figure drawings?
I also agree. I think they're very fun. I also like the choice of the back, because really any part of the body has a lot of physical landmarks that you could explore in terms of your images. I also really like the choice of color. I feel like most people think, oh, figure drawing is going to be stuffy. I'm going to use black and white. I'm going to use charcoal. But I really like how Aurora kind of went outside of that. It seems like both marker and colored pencil, which is also really cool to see.
I mean, I'll tell you, Aurora, if you're watching this, I'm so proud of you with your bony landmarks. Look at this. It's like 7th cervical vertebrae. You've got the scapula in there. Oh, my anatomy art teacher soul is just so proud right now. I just love it. At the same time, though, this is a very painterly drawing. I mean, I feel like sometimes I see anatomy drawings and people get so uptight about those bony landmarks that they lose sight of the initial gesture. And I'll tell you guys, I love that really quick, almost impressionistic shadow that you're seeing on the lower left section of the figure. So really, really nice job, Aurora. Great to see what you're doing. So if you guys create something in response to one of our videos, go to artprof.org, click on tutorials. If you click on the purple button, you will find the ArtProf Share submission form. You can submit your work and let us know what you learned, and we might consider you for a YouTube shout out. Or another option, if you just want to show us and not submit, you can just tag us on Instagram. Use art.prof and do hashtag artprofshare. Ooh, cool. Aurora Brown is in the chat. I'm so glad you could watch this live. So exciting to see your work. Thank you so much for sharing that with us. Jordan, Kat, and I are going to be hanging out in the Discord. If you're not in the Discord, shame on you. The link is in the video description below. We will be in the channel that's called Post Live Streams. There's so many questions you guys asked and commented on that we totally did not have time to get to. So I'm really looking forward to getting in there and talking to you guys about this topic, because, wow, it's a big one that we're talking about. Subscribe to our channel and join the Art Prof family. And thank you so much to our top Patreon supporters who make all of this possible. Thank you to everybody for having these conversations. We don't have any of the answers here necessarily, okay? We're not here to tell you guys things should be a certain way, but we are here to open a conversation, to get people thinking, to get people considering things that they may not have thought about before. And that's the best we can do. So everybody, thank you so much. We'll see you in the Discord in a little bit. Stay safe. We'll see you next time. Bye.